Good morning, everybody. Just woke up and I need to take a shower, make some coffee, and then I really want to tell you about the monitors that I got in my studio. So by now you should have figured out that I purchased a set of Atom A7X monitors. You guys, they're so good. I cannot stress that enough. And I'm going to be sort of fanboying out over these monitors for the next few minutes as I tell you what it is like to own a pair of these monitors, okay? So in full disclosure mode, got no discount on these, paid for these with my own money that, you know, a lot of the Patreon money. Thank you to my patrons. Thank you to everybody who's been hiring me for session work over the last few years. I was taking all that money and building up a nest egg of cash so I could actually start building the recording studio that I wanted, but you know, I needed the money to do it. So it took me a long time to save it up, but yeah, it was, I got a great preamp, then I got a great outboard compressor, and the last piece of the puzzle were these monitors. These are by far the nicest monitors that I've ever owned. And keeping in mind that years and years ago, I had a really sweet set of Tannoys. They were passive. I cannot remember the model number, but they were really, really nice 8-inch Tannoys that I had years and years ago. But in my old studio when I still lived in Santa Fe, New Mexico. But those are long gone. And then I was sort of building my way back up to get some nicer gear and to get some nicer monitors. So what is it like to listen to these things, especially my own mixes? It's fabulous and it's sort of depressing all at the same time. I went back to a few of my older Music Monday songs, listened to them, especially the ones that I knew the mixes weren't great on. Like, you know, those songs happen in such a short period of time. It's no doubt that I'm gonna make a couple of mix mistakes. I get super exhausted by the end of those days. But when I listened to them on these monitors, I really truly thought, like, wow, if I'd had these monitors way back then, those mistakes just would not have happened because of the way these sound and the way they translate the sound. It is just delicious is a really good word. It is so, they're just so good. You hear every little detail. You hear stuff in, you know, my favorite recordings like Beatles albums and stuff like Sgt. Pepper. I was listening to Sgt. Pepper through these and I suddenly heard all these things I'd never ever heard in that album. And I have listened to that thousands of times. So that was one of those moments where I was like, whoa, wait, what's going on? That has been in the recording the entire time and I never heard it. That is a true testament to how good these monitors are. So the ribbon tweeters, let me tell you, the high-end information that it gives you is so, so detailed. There is no way around it. Like, you can hear every little thing up there and it is so great. It has improved my acoustic guitar recordings and mixes by far. You know, I can finally truly hear the pick attack on the strings. I can really properly hear the low end and the mid range. When I was researching and reading about these monitors, one of the things that kept popping up in a lot of articles and a lot of, you know, reviews were the mid/bass woofers. I was really intrigued by that term, right? That mid/bass. I talk about mid-range all the time here on my channel. Everybody else is like really overly concerned with like the high end and the low end, and very few people actually take the time to consider the importance of the mid-range, right? Doesn't matter if you're choosing monitors or microphones, this is an essential part of what you're trying to get, right? You must understand that when you're listening to things and trying to make a decision, you guys, do yourself a favor and genuinely focus on the mid-range as well. I mean, of course, listen to the highs, listen to the lows, but listen to that mid-range because it is crucial that that information is accurate and not only accurate, but really nice to listen to. That's what these are. Now, I did actually go and I listened to the Neumanns, I listened to the Genelex, and I listened to these, and these were my favorite to listen to. The budget was a huge issue when it came to the Genelex. The Genelex are double this, but I don't actually think they're like double better sounding. Does that make any sense? You know what I'm trying to say? Like, I think the improvement in sound between these and the Genelex, I don't see that as a improvement that is worth double the money. Yeah, they're better, but at the same time, I thought the Genelex were a little bit sterile sounding, and it just sort of, I don't know. I hope someday to get a pair, but I hope that I'm in a better space for a pair of Genelex, but I don't know. I wasn't like jumping up and down. When I listened to these, I was like, whoa, those are so, so nice. I had never actually listened to Adams before, maybe a couple times at NAMM, but it's like really impossible to hear anything at the NAMM show. So yeah, they are just, they're gorgeous. They are phenomenally good, okay? So a couple things that I really, really love about them is the front-facing bass ports. Such a great idea. Love that the power switches are on the front, and I love that the volume knobs are on the front. I hate when things are hidden on the back, except for the, you know, the inputs for the cables. That's the only thing that should be on the back, if you ask me. All the controls should be up front. Now, there are EQ switches. All of mine are set to flat, because that's where I like them in this space, and that's that, right? The other thing that I do truly recommend is that if you get any set of monitors, cheap or expensive, take the time to break them in. There is lots of information out on the internet about how to break in monitors. There are, you know, all sorts of things. You can just play on YouTube and play frequencies and play the white noise and play the brown noise and all these different things. But it takes hours and hours and hours. I have about 26 hours of break-in time on these. I want to put another 14 hours into the break-in process. But yeah, just take the time because it really did make them sound better. And I actually ran my MTM monitors, these guys right here, I ran them at the same time. And I've been listening to them for about a year, maybe 2 years, I can't remember. So they've been relatively well broken in, but after I ran the test stuff through it, oh my gosh, they actually did open up. The mid-range especially, the mid-range especially opened wide up on the MTMs after I'd gone in through the break-in process. So yeah, make sure you do that if you buy good monitors. If you're somebody who's really trying to take your mixing seriously and wants to make the best possible sounding mixes you can, you do have to spend the money to get the gear, right? I was talking about this earlier, but you know, these are the kinds of tools that you need. So yeah, get good at saving money, people, because it's so great to have this stuff in my home and to be able to use it in my studio. It has made a humongous difference in my mixing life and my world and all that kind of stuff. I'm just, you know, I'm better at it because these monitors help me get to that point. And it is really important to me. I want this little studio to sound as good and as professional as I possibly can. And it does require that you buy the gear, right? So, you know, I got that awesome Heritage Audio compressor, I got the awesome Heritage Audio preamp, and now I have these awesome Atom A7X monitors. It is a little bit of a mouthful, A7X, I don't know. Yeah, 7-inch monitors in this 10x10 room, perfect. 8-inch monitors, too big. With the treatment and everything that I have in here, I was very well aware after I got the treatment up that the 8-inch monitors were just too big. They were sending so much low end behind me, and whenever I would mix, I could hear all this jambalaya going on behind my head, and I could really like, I need to get the better monitors into this space. 8 inches, like I said, too big for a small 10x10 room. 7 inches, perfect. It's not a huge difference physically, but sonically it makes a massive difference in a smaller room. And that is something that is very important, and you guys should all do research on acoustics, you know, the way the bass frequencies work and how high frequencies work. Do the research. It's all super fascinating. Acoustics, room acoustics, speaker acoustics, there is no shortage of information out there, and it's all fascinating to read. And again, if you're really serious about getting your mixes to that high professional level, this is the kind of information you need to be aware of. So hopefully I'm like at least, you know, giving you a question mark, something to go research after you watch this video. So all I want to say is at the end here is they are phenomenally good, and I love them. I love them so much, and I'm just so happy that I got them. And again, thank you to my patrons on my Patreon page for helping me get them. And also thank you to everybody who has hired me as a session musician for their recordings, wherever they may be on the planet. I've done a bunch of session work over the last, well, several years, but yeah, it's you guys all pitched in and I really appreciated it. And it's awesome. So have a great weekend. Peace and love, and now stick around for the terrible demonstration or comparison between my old M-Audio BX-8 D2s and the Atoms, okay? You guys, have a good weekend.
To rain. Everybody's running, searching for some cover. I took a photograph, yes, I took a photograph. Easy to remember this way. And even though you left, I was getting better.